NDTV. And you're watching NDTV 24/7.
Hello and welcome to How Safe Is Your Money? I'm Amitabh Ravi. We're discussing the global financial crisis and how it's affecting us all here. Senior business expert Sushma Ramachandran and an expert on aviation and tourism, Subhash Goyal, will answer all your questions. We are focusing today on uncertainty that's continuing on the markets and the effect of the weakening rupee on your plans, whether it's traveling abroad, whether you're an importer or an exporter. So you can call in whatever your question is. Every day from 5:30 p.m. onwards, Indian Standard Time. You can also call in on this number, in fact, 011-262-0166. You can SMS us your questions on those numbers on your screen, depending on where you are across the world. We're just looking at the Sensex today. The Sensex is down about 2%, just over 2%, but it has recovered from its intraday low. It was down at one point over 700 points, I beg your pardon, but it's now down on about 227 points. The Nifty also losing 2%, but both markets recovering towards the end of the day. Let's quickly get in our first caller. TV Kumar from New Delhi joins us. Mr. Kumar, you have invested in mutual funds and you want to know something about that?
Yeah, that's right, that's right.
Go ahead. Hello. Ask your question, Mr. Kumar.
Yeah, in fact, I put in roughly around, say, 4 lakhs in mutual fund and different funds. I took the premier funds, I can name Franklin Prima, Franklin Blue Chip, and similarly DST Merrill Lynch Tiger Fund. Soon, I've taken somewhere around 12 to 13 funds, which are the best performing funds. And I know the global meltdown has taken place, and it has drastically affected our listing also. Now the question is, I have put in all in this actually, but even if I calculate, I feel I am down by 60%.
You're down at 60% now, but yeah. Is it advisable to pull out?
No, I think, of course, he has apparently invested a large sum of money in mutual funds. 12 to 13 funds is a large number to be handling, you know, simply in terms of management. So I would assume he has a portfolio manager. Clearly, of course, right now the markets are, we can't say they're bottomed out because we really don't know right now what's happening. I think the conventional wisdom, and right now everyone is saying that you need to hold on to your investments, especially in mutual funds, because sure. Mutual funds are the safest way of investing in the equity markets. You have a professional manager who is taking care of your money. After all, what is a mutual fund? A mutual fund is a vehicle which invests on your behalf and tries to invest in the kind of stocks and in the manner that you want. So the market, of course, is low. I think the gentleman needs to just wait it out for a while. And though his profits, the value of whatever he's invested has come down, I think he just needs to lie low for the time being. I think one thing that needs to be remembered when you're investing in equity is that these should be your surplus funds. So we are presuming that the funds that he has are his surplus funds and they do not affect his day-to-day operations.
So the advice usually, even with the mutual funds and shares, is if you invested, then stay in there for the long time. In fact, now when we're focusing on foreign exchange rate, we've got an interesting question here now from Praveen in Melbourne. Praveen, you want to ask a question related to the weakening of the rupee?
That's right.
Go ahead, ask your question.
That's right.
Praveen, we can hear you. Can you ask your question to our guests?
Like one Australian dollar is equal to 20, 30 rupees.
Go on. There is a delay in the line here, but go on with your question and complete it.
So is it better to purchase Australian dollars now?
You know, is he talking in reference to compared to U.S. dollars?
Are you talking about the U.S. dollar, Australian dollar exchange rate or the rupee, Australian dollar exchange rate? I presume it's the rupee, Australian dollar.
rupee Australian dollar. Yeah. But I think that you know, if he's interested in taking any action on you know, purchase of dollars, I think he should wait once again, because right now the rupee has depreciated a great deal. So I think that right now is not the time to take any steps as far as currency purchases are concerned. You really need to wait. The market is extremely volatile, and we need to wait for at least 1 or 2 weeks to see how things are going to pan out.
Right. And that brings me to the point of, is it also not the right time, Mr. Goel, to travel abroad because of the weakening rupee?
No, I don't think so, because you see, there are two types of people who are going abroad. One is to the nearby destinations like Bangkok, Kuala Lumpur, Singapore, Dubai, Sri Lanka, Nepal. Now, those people are mostly on a very tight budget. So probably there we might expect a little slowdown of 5 to 10%, but we have not witnessed this as
so
of
far.
Now.
Okay.
As far as the long haul travel is concerned,
especially
in
to
fact,
the US,
mainly the US, we don't think that there is going to be any slowdown. Because
you
a person
hope or you are
no
really
we are sure.
Okay.
We are sure for the simple reason that a person who's spending, you know, 1 lakh rupees on an air ticket, for him to spend 5 or 10,000 rupees more does not make a difference.
But is it really that much? Because I know of a person in case who's trying to travel back from the States, and that person, when they had gone there, had gone on a ticket which is probably around 49,000 rupees return, and they are now looking at it closer to 70,000. Buying it in the US, not buying it here.
Yeah, I mean, if you buy it in the US, probably I will not be able to comment on that market. But as far as fares out of India and international fares out of India, they haven't gone up that drastically.
So are you saying the fares are not connected to the fluctuation in the rupee in India?
No, I don't think so. But as far as this present, you know, mergers and acquisitions which are taking place in the Indian aviation thing, there is a possibility that we might see fares going up.
Sure.
But as of today, the fares are not up, and we are not seeing any downward trend as far as outbound travel out of India is concerned.
But theoretically, Ramchandran, travel should be affected, shouldn't it, especially to the US?
Well, I think the fact is that the depreciation of the rupee has just taken place.
Okay.
So I mean, it was just barely a month ago that the RBI was trying to ensure that the rupee does depreciate. It had appreciated too much about a month and a half back. And this whole crash or slump of the rupee has taken place only recently.
Right.
And just like you have heard of someone, I also know someone who had planned a package trip to Bangkok, and he's now decided, all right, let's go to Kerala instead.
Okay.
Because the fares have gone up, and you know, some people are not price sensitive, as Mr. Goel says, but some people are price sensitive.
In fact,
know.
It's really interesting that you brought up the Bangkok and Kerala example, because we have a caller from Bangalore now, Sarah, who wants to go to Bangkok, but is thinking again. Sarah?
Hi. Hello.
Yeah, go ahead with your question, Sarah.
Well, I was supposed to have gone to Bangkok this month, but then it was extremely expensive for me to make the flight travel. So I was just wondering if, I wanted to know exactly why, what is happening.
Well, I can assure you one thing, that today, if you're talking about a five-star hotel, then Kerala is more expensive than Bangkok.
Okay.
Still, it is cheaper. I have a package which is cheaper to go to Bangkok, Kuala Lumpur, or even Sri Lanka and Singapore than a package with the airfares, the domestic airfares which have gone up, then to Kerala.
Okay, so we'll get Sarah in touch with you straight after this show, and you can give her that package, Mr. Goel.
Anyone, not a problem.
But is it just the rupee and the dollar, or is the rupee being affected with other currencies as well? Because he's making the point that if it's not the US, maybe...
No, ultimately everything, you
because
know...
Because it's not just travel. Once you go
yes,
to that place,
exactly,
you're spending.
Yes, exactly. But you know, what happens is that, you know, the dollar is the currency of exchange.
Yeah.
When you're going from here, you're always buying dollars. And then you, once again, you reconvert them into the currency of that particular country. So, you know, it is the key currency. And even now, in fact, globally, actually, the dollar is, despite the fact that the U.S. economy is in such distress and there's a recession, the dollar is actually becoming stronger, because people are coming back to the dollar as, you know, it is the key currency of the world, the global currency, and they're coming back to in refuge like gold. So sure. The dollar
is it, but is it also because so much money or so much dollars are being put into the bailout package, so there's a shortage of dollars?
That is of course there. Now, for instance, in India, why has the rupee depreciated? I think that's the foreign institutional investors pulled out their funds from India, from the stock markets here, simply because they required a large amount of those funds as because of the meltdown in the US. Now, when they came out, they sucked out a large amount of dollars. And in the meantime, the RBI had been trying, as I said, to bring the rupee, to depreciate the rupee, and there was no strategy really to push up, to appreciate the rupee. In fact, exporters have been demanding for a long time that the RBI should intervene, you should bring down the value of the rupee against the dollar.
Sure.
So in all this scenario, suddenly the value of the rupee against the dollar has slumped.
Now, when we have programs like this, when experts do talk, we tend to use a lot of jargon. I know you want to make one, I just want to get in another caller here.
Yeah.
There's a liquidity crisis, there's a credit crunch. Veer Ganesh from Chennai wants to ask a very layman perspective question. Veer?
Yeah, hi Amitabh.
Hi, go on.
I've it's all over the news to do with the financial crisis, and just from a layman's perspective, I'm just looking to understand as to, we have a lot of talk where the government's, giving a lot of money to the banks. Chidambaram just announced about 25,000 crores. So I'm really, quite puzzled, and I don't quite understand as to why, so much of money is being, given to banks. Even in the U.S. we have, Bush announcing a lot of money. So, why exactly are the banks being given so much of money? Is it, is there a crisis to do with that, or just looking to understand that part of it?
This is the most difficult part to explain. A very complicated situation.
Yeah. Well, the fact is that the government is actually, by infusing this 25,000 crore into the system, is trying to bring confidence back to the banking system. In fact, the Indian banking system is very strong. I must assure your caller that our banking system is in a really good condition. Public sector banks, your money is safe. Even private sector banks, your money is safe. But this is a measure of confidence, because there has been it's a fallout of what has happened abroad. There is a liquidity crisis abroad. And if I go into it, it would be a very long explanation. But the basic fact is that there's a lack of confidence. And the
lack of confidence was meaning that there was no money
banks,
to be...
No, banks lent. Within the country, for instance, even in India, are a little hesitant to lend to each other. Even though they are aware of the fact that they are strong, but because of the nervousness that has come in, that has been infected by the global markets, they are a little nervous, and Mr. Chidambaram and the RBI are trying to infuse more confidence into the system.
Right.
So I must assure your callers that there is no fear of they are losing any of their money in their banks. It's all very safe.
Let's just talk about investing in India. You were talking about how those dollars were sucked out when FIIs took away their money. Well, an interesting question coming in from Malti from Canada. Malti?
Yeah, hello.
Yeah, ask your question, Malti.
Yeah, I was thinking of buying some property in Chennai. So I want to know if this is the right time, or should I wait a year or so, because I believe the prices are coming down.
Well, as far as the real estate sector is concerned, there is talk that, property prices are going to come down. It's not in a very good state. So perhaps she could wait for a while. And see, once again, this is a very volatile scenario as far as the entire economy is concerned. So real estate prices may fall further. So if she takes a decision now, she may regret it. And at the same time, I have to say, as many other analysts and economists are saying, whenever the media talks to them, we really don't know what's going to happen tomorrow.
Sure.
Everything is a kind of guesstimate right now.
You can't even forecast the weather.
Exactly.
So how can we forecast? You wanted to make a quick point before we go into
it. With all these FDIs, foreign institutional investors pulling out of the stock exchange,
right.
I see a great opportunity for India, and particularly for inbound tourism. Because today, traveling within India, and you get more value for your dollars.
Okay.
Okay.
So this is a good time.
You're not talking about domestic tourism, you're talking about inbound,
foreign tourists coming into India. So I think it's a very good time for people to visit India. And the government, and I've been saying this for the last 20 years, that the government should focus more on inbound tourism, because this is the wealth which is going to stay in this country.
Sure.
And it creates millions of jobs. Sure. You see, rather than just this institutional investment, which is more, I would say, a gamble. Whereas inbound tourism, the money it brings in, stays in the country, and
exactly
it has a multiplier effect
we are doing
on jobs.
For so many other countries,
so
and we travel
that is
abroad.
Why what the government and our planners should do is to encourage
sell
the sector.
India as a destination.
Yeah, and encourage the tour operators, remove the bottlenecks which are there, like service tax, which is really killing the tourism industry and making it less competitive.
So 20 years they haven't listened to you, hopefully they're listening to this program, but we'll take a short break and come back and answer your questions. You're watching How Safe Is Your Money, and we've got two guests here who are looking at both travel and tourism and the Sensex and investments. So Goyal, just a quick question to you. Crude prices have fallen to almost 50% from off their highs. Why is aviation turbine fuel prices not going down?
You see, in India, we are overtaxing the aviation turbine fuel. Even international carriers are feeling the pinch, because the amount of tax they have to pay on international aviation turbine fuel is nowhere else in the world. It's the highest, and some of the states, except Andhra Pradesh, and during Naidu's time, it was reduced to 4%. Rest of the states, it's tremendous. And that is what is affecting the bottom line. I mean, today...
It's about 40% of airline's cost, is that correct?
It is about 30%.
30%.
About 27 to 30% of the DOC, which is the direct operating cost of an airline.
Yeah.
I mean, there are other costs, but so this is because fixed costs cannot be reduced.
So your solution is that those taxes have to be brought.
They have to be completely
down.
Scrapped.
Completely
I mean,
scrapped.
If this aviation industry and tourism industry.
20 years it has taken you to get the government to talk about tourism.
To
it
open
may
the
take
skies.
You another 40 years you see, for the taxes to be scrapped. I have to wrap this discussion. Talking about the Sensex, there are two views at looking at it. It's still in the red.
Yeah.
The other way to look at it is it actually fell a lot and is recovered towards the end. So that's a positive trend.
Yeah.
Which way do you look?
I think it's a positive trend, because compared to other economies around the world, our Sensex hasn't fallen to the extent that, I mean, it's about 1 to 2%, and everywhere else things are tumbling at the rate of 5 to 7%. So I think that's
and
a positive
trend
indicator.
Seems to have been reversed at the
we
end.
We are,
of
let, you know, we, ca-
know
we can't really say it's bottoming out, but it looks like we're reaching the end of the tunnel.
Right. So, thanks so much for joining us here on the show and answering all our viewers' questions all around the globe they were calling in from. So you can also call in whatever your question is and how it's going to affect you, whether you're here in India or whether you have anything to do with India and how the financial crisis will affect you. Call in every day, 5:30 p.m. onwards. The number that you can call on is 011-262-0166. Thanks for watching.
NDTV. And you're watching NDTV 24/7.